So today the idea is to continue a little bit with what we started the previous two sessions. So talk more about coronary artery disease. And so the first session was more about structure and what's changing. And then last time was about what's happening in acute coronary artery disease. And now we will extend that a little bit towards a little bit more chronic situation. Okay, so just to repeat from last time, so what is important when you look at coronary artery disease, so what you get is, of course, in your territory at risk, which is normally perfused with the coronary artery that is being occluded or partially occluded. So when you look at deformation, what happens, as showed here in this slide, so with acute occlusion, what you get is, of course, because there's no oxygen anymore locally, what you get is a decrease in the systolic deformation. And then later on, when the pressure drops, what you get is you get a passive elastic interaction between segments which have deformed more and segments which have deformed less, and you get post-systolic deformation. If it's an acute occlusion and you reperfuse relatively quickly, so within a few minutes, then actually it fully recovers or can become even a little bit hyperemic in some cases. But you see that there's nothing left of these abnormalities anymore. Now, if instead of a full total occlusion, you gradually decrease the flow, what you see is that with a decrease of flow, you have a linear decrease of systolic deformation and you get the concomitant post-systolic deformation. So that's a little bit the idea. So there is a clear relation between the amount of systolic deformation or deformation during the ejection that you can have and the perfusion that you can have. And because this abnormal segment then shows differential deformation with regard to neighboring segments, then that's being expressed as post-systolic deformation. Now, the first chronic in brackets kind of substrate that you can have in coronary artery disease is what's called stunned myocardium. Yeah, because what you know is like if you reperfuse patients that have been kind of partially occluded for a long period, it also, even if the flow is absolutely totally normalized acutely after the reperfusion, what you see is that it takes weeks up to months for the myocardium to fully recover normal function. So there's a delay between the functioning of the myocardium, the thickening, the shortening, and the reperfusion after a prolonged episode of kind of hypoperfusion. Now, here is an animal model showing what's going on there. So what you can do is you can create a stunned model in brackets by first inducing ischemia. So you induce in the area at risk that you see here, which is colored. What you do is you do a severe decrease in coronary flow. You don't do a full obstruction, because if you do a full obstruction, then obviously you get a developed infarct. But in order for stunning, what you do is you do kind of severe hypoperfusion, but just enough to keep the tissue alive. So, of course, during that episode of hyperperfusion, you get what we said before. Reduced perfusion leads to decreased systolic deformation and post-systolic deformation. Now, if after a prolonged period, in this case, it was an animal model with 60 minutes, so an hour of occlusion, if you then reperfuse, and if you didn't do a full total occlusion, as I said before, you don't have damage, but what you will see is that you don't get full recovery of the deformation. So you get at baseline in brackets after a prolonged period of ischemia, you get less systolic deformation and post-systolic deformation. While here, there's nothing wrong with the perfusion. So this is normally perfused with a full open artery, because this was like a partial balloon occlusion. So what you see is here, you get this abnormality. So this is what we call stunned. If you would leave this now, then after a couple of weeks, probably this would recover and become totally normal. Now, the question is now, of course, is like, how can you distinguish a deformation pattern with decreased systolic deformation and post-systolic deformation, which is because of stunning of the myocardium, but with normal perfusion versus a piece of tissue which is hypoperfused. right? Because with hypoperfusion, as we said before, you get very, very much the same. So it's the same deformation pattern, but for a totally different substrate. Now, the way to differentiate this is actually by using dobutamine. So doing a stimulation of the myocardium, trying to increase the contractility. And as I said before, here is like normal myocardium. Well, actually here in this case, this is looking at two regions of the same heart, but I come back to what I said before. So in normal myocardium, what you get is when you give dobutamine, you increase deformation. So you get an increase in strain, at least for low doses of dobutamine. And later on with high doses, what happens is that actually strain decreases. But that's because of the fact that, of course, your heart rate becomes so high that your filling period becomes too short and you don't fill anymore. And as we said before, deformation is related to stroke volume. If you don't have stroke volume to generate, then of course you will have less deformation. So this is the normal response to dobutamine. And what we actually see in the stunned segment is that when giving dobutamine, what you see is that actually you will increase the systolic deformation and you will actually get less post-systolic deformation. So dobutamine can normalize the deformation in stunned myocardium. And we will see that that is very different from hypoperfused myocardium. Now, the first thing is to understand this and to understand where stunning comes from is trying to see is like, what is in the anti-substrate to cause this, that with normal perfusion, you will have abnormal deformation. And here is a very interesting study that kind of shows what could be going on. And what it shows is that when you look at your contractile material, so normally your actin myosin, they're interleaved and they have a geometry with regards to each other, which is absolutely perfect for cross-bridge interaction and develop the force that is needed for the contraction. Now, when you have hypoperfusion for a long time and you then suddenly reperfuse, what you will see is that, of course, there will be an ion imbalance, because if it was hyperperfused for a long time, that means that there was not enough oxygen, but also other ions. So that means that the ion concentration in the cells there was changed. If you then fully reperfuse, what you do is, of course, you get a mismatch in ion concentration between the intracellular space and the blood. And it means that actually the cells are starting to kind of swell. So you get local edema. And when you get this local edema, what happens is that actually the spacing between your actin and myosin can alter. And so you get a little bit of change in the spacing of actin and myosin, which means that of course it's less efficient, which means that although the tissue, the cells are absolutely totally normal, normally perfused, structurally normal, the amount of force development that they can develop is of course reduced by the fact that you have changed their geometry. And of course, this intracellular edema that takes quite a long time to resolve. So that's why it can take weeks for it to become absolutely totally normal. And also, given the fact that the structure of your contractile material is totally preserved, that means that, of course, if you give dobutamine and you know that the perfusion is normal, so the dobutamine can easily go to the tissue, and of course, the contractile cells are actually responding to dobutamine and will increase their force development. Although it will also always be a little bit less efficient than the non-kind of edematous cells, you will see this increase and you're not getting a differential change between the normal and the abnormal tissue. So you really see that this can respond to dobutamine. Now, when we are looking at tissue which is still hypoperfused, so where there's no flow or no kind of flow reserve, as we say, what's happening now is if we give dobutamine, what you will see that in ischemic segments, you will see that actually systolic deformation goes down and post-systolic deformation goes up. And the reason for this is obviously if you have a segment which is hypoperfused, and because of this, as we said before, has lower systolic deformation and post-systolic deformation, but it has no coronary flow reserve. That means that if you now give dobutamine, of course, the dobutamine is not getting there. But the dobutamine is obviously getting to the neighboring segments, and the neighboring segments, they are kind of responding to the dobutamine, while the abnormal can't respond. I mean, there is no reserve to respond. And so what you effectively do with the dobutamine is you increase the deformation of the neighboring segments, which means that, of course, you're going to change the interaction in some ways, because the difference between the normal and abnormal becomes bigger, which means, again, that you have, because the normal myocardium is developing more force, potentially a bit more pressure, means more decrease of systolic deformation in the abnormal, more interaction, because the difference is bigger, it means more post-systolic. But you see in the dobutamine response, of ischemic myocardium or kind of ongoing ischemia, so non-reperfused myocardium, you see that dobutamine exaggerates the difference between two segments and thus gets more post-systolic and less systolic deformation. While in stunned myocardium, dobutamine will also increase the deformation or the force development in the stunned myocardium, and thus would more or less normalize or at least increase the deformation. And so you see, while at baseline, you cannot distinguish these two substrates, what you can is by giving this dobutamine stimulation, you can get information. So here you will see that, and actually in a lot of cases, what you need to do is you need to do some kind of provocation, whether it's with dobutamine or with exercise testing, in order to kind of differentiate different substrates or highlight abnormalities. Because as you see here, with even a relatively low dose of dobutamine, because the maximum dose of dobutamine is 40 mics, and sometimes they can even give atropine or adenosine or something like that additionally. So this is a relatively low dose. You see that you exaggerate what you see with ischemia while you more or less normalize what you would see in stunned myocardium. So this is a way to kind of look at these different substrates. Now, if we go into true chronic infarctions or abnormalities, then I just show you again this slide that I showed before. So this is some synchrotron images and histology images of a rat model with, in this case, a full total occlusion of the LAD. So you see the infarct becoming very thin. So it's being replaced by, you have a lot of fibrosis. You still have a little bit of kind of normal cells in the epi and endo. But what's also quite interesting is, like, if you start to look at cell sizes, for example, your peri-infarct region and even the contralateral wall, what you see is you see compensatory changes. So you can see hypertrophy in these areas. And you can, of course, imagine that already when you start to look at the cells that are still left in this infarct region, so the subendo and subepicardial, that also these myocytes, when there's a chronic infarction, have remodeled. So they likely, because they're under much higher wall stresses, they likely become, for example, hypertrophic. And you can actually nicely see that. So this is some work from the group of Karen Cipido and Leuven, where an animal model of infarction, of chronic infarction, was actually used. And then cells were, cardiomyocytes were isolated and then individually investigated. And one of the things that you could see there, and this is actually coming back to what we said discussed last time, this is one of the settings where you could have, like, for example, a prolonged force development, at least in isolated myocytes. So the onset of the stimulation here is exactly the same, but what you see is in the chronic ischemic cells, which are, of course, not necrotic, so the cells that are still available in the infarct region, or at least in the peri-infarct region, what you see there is you get reduced overall force development and you get a prolongation of the force development in this case. Of course, this partially will change when you have it embedded in the myocardium, but it tells you that actually chronic kind of hyperperfusion can induce different alteration in the myocytes. What you see is, like, you get a little bit of hypertrophy, not so much, but you mainly get some dilatation, which of course is related to what we said before. You get dilatation of the whole heart in order to kind of compensate for the stroke volume. We come back to that in another session when we talk about volume overload. Of course, also when you have this kind of prolongation of the cells or elongation of the cells, you will change your conduction through the cells, you will change your passive properties, so that will change also. What we have been showing, and we come back to that also in another session, for example, in hypo or kind of hypoxia in fetuses, is that you can see that there's mitochondrial changes. So your energy efficiency can also change, which would partially kind of explain this kind of decreased contractility or also even the slower slope. What you will see is that also actually titin inside will change, and so it changed the passive properties. And another thing which I think is sometimes underappreciated and is actually quite difficult to see is, or difficult to study, is actually when you look at myosin, there's several isoforms. You have, for example, an alpha and a beta isoform of myosin. And actually, what you see is that one of these is kind of consuming less energy, but can also do less force development. And so you get mostly when you see this type of things where you have less force development, that means that, for example, you have this, like that you have changed towards one of the isoforms of myosin, which can work under more hypoxic conditions, because this is still a kind of ischemic region, but develops kind of less force in this case. And obviously, together with that, these are kind of cellular changes, you have matrix changes. Eh? So, and the result of this all, of course, contributes to what we see, is that in kind of ischemic myocardium, you have, since you have less force development, of course, you have less deformation, and then you get the post-systolic deformation. And so when you look at these substrate, so say that we have a condition where we have kind of a subendocardial infarction. So what I showed you before also is that when you look at the coronary circulation, so the coronary circulation is with the big vessels at the epicardium, and then the coronaries go towards the inside, so transmurally towards the endocardium. And so when you have problems with the coronaries, it's always the endocardium which is the most vulnerable. And so the endocardium is what's actually where you get cell death first. So if you have an occlusion which lasts for a certain amount of time, what you will see is that you start to have this wave phenomena. So where your endocardium is kind of getting infarcted. And then depending on the time, you will have more and more transmural towards the epicardium. So if you have a situation where reperfusion was done before you have a full transmural infarction, what you will see is that your endocardial layer is actually replaced by fibrosis. So only kind of there's no living myocytes there, or virtually none, while the epicardium can still be preserved. Keep in mind, as we said before, there's always this very thin endocardial layer which survives, because that is being perfused by diffusion from within the cavity. But you see that most of the endocardial layer is gone. So that means that when you look at the whole wall or the whole segment, you see that you lost half of your contractile material, which of course means the overall force development will be much less also. Right? It can partially be compensated by hypertrophy from the epicardial cells, but it never can be fully compensated. And so when we look at that, so this is kind of pre-infarct. After the subendocardial infarct, you see chronically that you get a decrease in the systolic deformation and you get post-systolic deformation. So again, you get a very similar substrate as you see in an acute kind of hyperperfusion, but now it's because, of course, not because you get overall the whole segmental decrease in contractile force because of hyperperfusion. What you get here is you get the overall kind of force development decrease because you lost half of your myocardium. Now, here you can see something similar. So wherever you lose myocardial cells, you will get this. So here's an example where, so this is some kind of genetic cardiomyopathies, these measurements. We also can show that in more detail a bit later. But what you see is if you have localized fibrosis, well, of course, what you get is because of this localized fibrosis, you also get the decrease of the overall force development. And you see the same, you get this post-systolic there. So post-systolic, again, is very sensitive for changes. It's not specific for one kind of underlying kind of substrate or etiology. Now, if the occlusion was so long that we have a full transmural infarction, what you get is, of course, chronically, this is being replaced by scar. And so you have no kind of living myocardium there anymore. So what you have is you have a transmural kind of infarct. Now, the thing is then, that means that, of course, you have no myocytes anymore in order to do force development. So you have no force development. But at the other hand, also, your whole tissue is being replaced by scar. And we know that scar, predominantly collagen, is, of course, much stiffer than normal myocardium. And so what we get is we get and a change in the contractile force development and a change in the local elasticity. And remember this relationship. Eh? So when we go back to Hooke's law from physics, saying that there is a relation between forces and deformation through the elasticity. If you change both the forces and you change the elasticity, then of course you start to see different things. And what you see here is that you have no systolic force development because of the fact that, of course, you have no contractile material. But additionally, you have no post-systolic deformation because what you see is that the tissue becomes so stiff that even if the neighboring segments are contracting and much thicker, this interaction force is not enough to deform kind of very stiff tissue. So the second kind of need in order, condition in order to get post-systolic. Eh? So the first is you need to get differential deformation of different segment, and you have to have retained elasticity in order to have post-systolic deformation. So if you don't have contractile force development and you have altered elasticity, what you see is you have virtually no kind of deformation. So you really have a wall which is not deforming and it just moves along with the other segments. So that's what you get in a transmural infarction. And so you can actually show that there's almost a linear relation between the amount of systolic deformation and the amount of transmurality or the extent of your scar tissue, where you see that from normal tissue, you get a decrease with going towards zero deformation when you have a full transmural infarction. Okay, so now there's another substrate, or the substrate can change if you have like a total occlusion for a long time, so that you even have kind of almost scar development, but or if you have like a 90 minutes, for example, or a couple of hours of occlusion, what you have is, of course, you have no scar development, but you have clearly cell death. And if you then do a reclusion. Yeah, so this is actually quite important because how do you manage this in practice? Eh? So what you hope nowadays, especially with what they say is this acute PCI, eh? So or a kind of emergency PCI, what happens is a patient that gets symptoms of a heart attack, what you hope is that within an hour or maximally within a couple of hours, that patient gets to the hospital and then gets a catheterization to be reperfused. And this way, depending on the time, you will see that you have either full recovery if it was fast or kind of a more and more transmural infarction if it was too slow. But what do you do with a patient which had like an infarct for a couple of hours, for example? Or what do you do with a patient which had weeks of a total occlusion by either not going to the hospital or not being close enough to the service or things like that? What do you do then? Do you then still reperfuse, yes or no? Because you know that after, say 90 minutes, you know that there will be cell death and this will lead to a full transmural infarction. What is then the best to have this to develop with an open artery or with a closed artery? And this is still a controversy within kind of interventional cardiology. That's why it's important to kind of understand what's going on there also. So here you see an example of this. So we have here at baseline, as we said before, normal systolic inward motion and thickening, and then kind of the monophasic kind of early kind of relaxation, outward motion. If we do an acute occlusion, as we said before, decreased systolic deformation, post-systolic deformation. The longer we keep it occluded, the less systolic deformation with post-systolic deformation. And so after a long time, what you see is that there's kind of virtually no systolic deformation, still a little bit of post-systolic deformation. Now, if you now reperfuse this, so if you now open this, so this again was an animal model with a balloon occlusion. So if you do now a kind of acute sudden opening of this vessel, what you now see is that actually this wall suddenly becomes very thick. If you compare here to normal, so this is the normal thickness at relaxation, so at end diastole. And what you see is that, of course, during systole, it thickens. So this is the thickness in full contraction. What you see here is after this acute reperfusion of long-standing kind of occlusion, you see that the wall becomes so thick that it's even at least as thick as during contraction, maybe even thicker. And what you also see is that this wall is moving, but you see there's no thickening whatsoever. There's no systolic thickening, there's no post-systolic thickening, nothing is happening with this thick wall. And this remains after reperfusion for a while. So what's going on here? Well, actually, when you start, what's happening is like now you get edema, but what you now get is you don't get intracellular edema as you would get with stunning, but what you do get is you get interstitial edema. So if this tissue was like hyperplased for a long time, or even with a total coronary occlusion, what happens is, of course, the cells are starting to die. They will release their local cytokines and things like that, which means that if you now reopen this vessel at high pressure, what you do there is, of course, there's an enormous ionic imbalance. And also because you go through this high pressure with damaged cells, what happens is you totally disrupt the tissue. You disrupt the tissue and it's being replaced. You kind of push it open and it's replaced by water. So all of this is like edema. It's like fluid, which is accumulating there. And of course, because of this, the wall becomes very thick. But at the same time, the wall becomes, of course, also very stiff. It's like a block of water, which is like totally non-compressible. And so when you look at the deformation, of course, it's like because of the fact that it was kind of hyperperfused or non-perfused for a long time, there's kind of cell damage, there will be no contractile force development. So that means there's no systolic thickening. And because of the fact that you have this edema, which makes the wall thick, that means that the wall is always thicker than, or at least never thinner than the neighboring normally contracting segment, which means that there's no interaction. So it's never that the neighboring segment can become thicker than this abnormal segment, which means there's no interaction, no interaction force, so no post-systolic deformation. The only thing that you get is this very thick wall, which moves up and down with the rest of the myocardium. Now, of course, this is not a great situation in the sense that this is like a massive block of tissue that needs to be displaced. Of course, the stresses there can become quite big. And this is one of the reasons also for, if you have a little bit of experience in interventional cardiology, what you see is that sometimes these patients, while they have a total occlusion, they are reasonably stable. But if you reperfuse them, they become hemodynamically unstable because what you give them is actually this massive thick wall, which of course kind of now starts to hamper even the deformation of the neighboring segments. So doing this kind of acute reperfusion of something that you know is kind of dead is maybe not always the best idea. Now, what is also interesting is that this is depending on the time when you do things. So here's an experiment that we actually did at some point where you say it's like, okay, if we reperfuse after different periods of full occlusion, is this always happening? What you see is that actually that this is happening in a certain time period. So a certain time period after a certain time period of full occlusion, if you then reperfuse, you get this phenomenon. If you do it early enough, you don't get it. You don't get any damage. So which is about the first 2 hours maybe or something like that. So if you're quick enough to reperfuse, you don't get this edema. You might get a little bit of stunning, but at least you don't get this kind of really local tissue damage. And if you wait long enough, so it means if you would wait days, for example, what you then also see is that you also don't get it. And the reason for this is, of course, that you're doing reperfusion at different time points of the kind of cellular changes. So if you do it fast enough, there's no cell death yet. So that means that there will be no edema, or at least no interstitial edema. If you do it after a certain period of time, what you will have is the cells have died and potentially the matrix is damaged. So that's where you get this clear edema. And if you wait long enough, what you see then is, of course, that the microvasculature there is also getting damaged. So if you have, for example, full thrombosis of the microvasculature, or you have full damage of the microvasculature, then even if you reperfuse, of course, you don't get kind of at least not high pressure perfusion in the infarcted region. And then of course you don't get any edema there also. Eh? And of course also after a long time, your iron imbalance has changed because of course the myocytes have been cleared out. Eh? So that means that there is a window in which you probably better do not reperfuse because you're going to make things worse. And if you then even go later, probably also you don't do anything with reperfusion because there is nothing to do anymore. This is also interesting when you look at other imaging modalities. Eh? So looking at deformation either by thickening in the M mode or by strain calculations, you can see this. But if you look at MRI, for example, where you can use T2 imaging in order to look at edema. So T2 imaging is specifically looking at increased water content. So that gives you an idea of edema. You actually see the same thing. So what you see there is you see this edema accumulation together with this abnormal deformation and actually thicker walls, which then, if you reperfused, all of this kind of very edematous wall that becomes transmural infarction later on, as you can see with the fibrosis. Now, actually, it becomes even more complex. We're not going to go in detail, but actually what you can see is that there's even different phases of edema. So you have this kind of very acute edema, as I was showing here. What you see there is that apparently this edema resolves, and then there can be like a second wave of edema after a week or something like that. So again, this can be important to look at patients. Eh? So that means that in the early period, they might be hemodynamically unstable because of this edema. Then they can recover, but then still a week later, they can show some signs of instability because of the second wave of edema. So when looking at this and looking at these transmural infarctions, it's really important to look at the timing. When are we reperfusing? When are we looking at it? When are we measuring it? And how does this then evolve towards later? So that means that there is no one type of deformation present. It really depends on the time course, the underlying substrate, and when you're doing these measurements. So when you look at the whole set then, so you have a whole bunch of ischemic substrates, and the way to discriminate these is first of all looking at what's happening at rest. Of course, how is this changing at rest? And secondly, is how is this, for example, reacting to a dobutamine stimulus? And here you see, as I said before, so I covered these different substrates. So you have normal tissue, you have stunt myocardium, which is normal tissue that had been hypoperfused for a while and is mechanically not recovered yet, but has normal perfusion. Then you have acute ischemia where you have hypoperfusion. And then you have the myocardial infarctions where you normally have normal perfusion or recovered, restored perfusion, but changes within the tissue. And you see actually that in all the abnormal kind of substrates, what you see is your systolic deformation goes down, both strain rate and strain, and you get post-systolic deformation. So again, what I said, post-systolic deformation is very sensitive to abnormalities. It's not very specific for a certain substrate. But if you give dobutamine, what we said before is dobutamine normalizes stunt myocardium, worsens acute ischemia, kind of significantly can worsen acute kind of transmural ischemia, and it will kind of differentially also change non-transmural versus transmural. Against transmural, in fact, nothing will happen, neither kind of at baseline, nor any response to dobutamine. A non-transmural infarct, what you will see is that it starts to kind of increase a little bit, but it cannot a lot. So it will never increase so much as stunt myocardium, because of course, you only have part of the myocardium still present and the rest is being replaced by scar. So by looking at these different patterns, you can actually try to look at the different substrates in some way. Okay. So let's then finalize with coming back to this example that I showed really when I started this ischemic event. So this is a patient where on admission, you see this kind of images where you clearly see that there's a very, very abnormal deformation in the apex here. Eh? You see this virtually, visually even, there's no deformation. There might be even a little bit of wiggling in the apex, which would point to post-systolic deformation. And you clearly see all the deformation is happening in the base. And you see that it's really the whole apex in all the areas that has this, which in some ways is weird, huh? Because when you look at the perfusion regions, in order to only have the full apex and the whole apex involved, that means that all the different coronary arteries have been involved, and you would need to have a distal occlusion of all the coronary arteries at the same time. This would be quite strange. So there's already something weird going on. And what we see is that after recovery, after the end of the episode in the hospital, what you see actually that this apex can actually recover. So that means that this is not an infarct, which will become kind of transmural scar, but you clearly see that this is some tissue that can respond. When we look at the angiography, and you see from the ventriculography that you really get this very typical thing where you have this bulge of the apex, eh? So you have a big bulge of the apex and you have a neck coming out of it. I'll come back to that later on, that actually gave it the name of this kind of syndrome. When we look at the vessels, what you see here is like, okay, the right coronary, there might be some kind of hazy changes, and there might be a reasonable stenosis here, but there's nothing, there's no clear obstruction in the distal part that could explain this kind of phenomena. Like when we look at the left, I mean, it's unlikely that these coronaries are the reason for this abnormal deformation. And what is also interesting is when we look at the history, it's first of all, it's an elderly woman, and it also happened on a very hot day while playing golf. So actually the history is actually quite important. Also the ECG does not show changes of abnormal tissue or the tissue changes that you would be associating to coronary artery disease. And there is some positive troponins, but there's no kind of CK changes. So all of this doesn't point to a massive myocardial infarction as you would see from these images. So what can you do then? Of course, what you can now do is do, as we said before, a deformation study and potentially a dobutamine study. And what you see there is that when we look at the apex here, so in this case, it's tissue Doppler-based strain, but you would see the same things with when you would do speckle tracking strain. What you clearly see is that in the kind of more like mid-apical region, what you see there is decreased systolic deformation, post-systolic deformation, and the real apex, the thing which is kind of visually not contracting, what you clearly see is there's pure stretching and a huge amount of post-systolic deformation. What you also see is that when we now would give dobutamine, what you see that actually this is improving. So this dobutamine was done like not at admission, but kind of a couple of days later, or like I think one day later or something like that. What you clearly see is that this abnormal deformation, the apex, is responding to the dobutamine. So when you think back of what we said before about the substrates, so if you have something which is abnormal at baseline and improves with the dobutamine, this is likely stunt myocardium. So that means that this is reperfused myocardium, so there's no coronary occlusion. And actually, this is kind of now known as a very typical syndrome, which is called Takotsubo or cardiomyopathy, Takotsubo syndrome, or apical ballooning. And this clearly, this ballooning of the apex is very typical. And Takotsubo is actually a pot that the Japanese are using to capture octopuses, which is actually in the shape where you have a ball and a very thin, long neck. And that's kind of resembles, when you look back to this angiography, this resembles this, of course. Huh? So you have this kind of balloon-shaped thing with a very thin neck. So this would be a Takotsubo pot, and that's why it's called like this. There's still a lot of controversy on why this is happening. One of the things that we have hypothesis, and what I think is actually happening, and you can see that, or you can look at that based on these echo images. So what you see here is that in recovery, you see this type of substrate. Eh? So what you get is it's quite a small ventricle with a clear basal septal hypertrophy. So it's important that it's relatively small, which you see more with women. And what you also have is, of course, with elderly women, what you get is there's quite a lot of hypertension there, or longstanding hypertension, which would induce this kind of septal hypertrophy. And what you can imagine now is if this ventricle would get dehydrated, so remember the history of this lady, it's like doing some sports on a hot day without drinking a lot. So if you would decrease the fluid content, what would happen is that actually here in this mid part, you would actually create a functional obstruction within the myocardium. So what you will get here is that because of the fact that this becomes so narrow, what happens is that, of course, you get a very high pressure in this apical part, and you get like a dynamic gradient, as we say, in this kind of mid part. And what happens is that because of this enormous pressure rise here, what happens is that, of course, the tissue is being damaged in brackets, or at least is functionally abnormal because of this high pressure, which means, again, that there would be less contractility. The base would contract even more, as you see here. You would create even more obstruction, so which would mean that you keep on having this very, very high pressure here, and this myocardium against this high pressure can, first of all, not contract, and secondly, well, then, of course, you will get also then kind of subendocardial ischemia because of this and things like that. So you are in a situation where you get like a functional induced kind of structural or functional induced deformation abnormality, which would be this whole substrate. And if now this person gets like gets resting, so the pressure would decrease, gets fluid administered, so that means that the ventricle will become larger again, you see that actually you get this kind of return to normal. So this seems to be the case here. But the most important here is that based on the deformation, together with the response of dobutamine, you can actually infer that this is not acutely ischemic myocardium. And so obviously, doing reperfusion is not useful here. Even doing an angiography, nowadays people know that doing an angiography here is likely also not very useful if you have this very kind of typical changes. So as summary, what is important or what we can learn from coronary artery disease, even besides trying to recognize it, is this link between force development and deformation. This helps us understand also other settings of deformation, where we have this relationship of force development, all force development, so myocardial contractility plus loading forces, and its relation to deformation through the elasticity of the tissue. So that's an important relationship. We know that systolic deformation is very much related to the local perfusion that you have there, and that this changes with decreased systolic deformation and then concomitant post-systolic deformation is very sensitive. You see it in almost all substrates where you have abnormalities in a certain kind of segment. And this post-systolic deformation will always be present there and is thus interesting to look at, but it's not sensitive in order to really look at the substrate. So you need to do some kind of stimulation, some modulation of contractility, and then check how this is changing in different segments in order to then understand the different substrate. Okay, I think that was enough for today. Are there any questions about this?
Hey, Bart. Hey, Philip. I'm just wondering, so this, what would be the clinical setting of this situation where we have perfusion, which is just would it be like a demand situation where we have high blood pressure and then we get myocardial injury because the perfusion and demand is mismatched, and then you get kind of a short-term perfusion deficit? Is that the short-term perfusion situation that you talk about, where it's just for a very short time and then you get stunt myocardium?
No, it's like when you have coronary artery disease and you start to get, for example, a critical stenosis. So if you have a critical stenosis, then what happens is there, it's either the stenosis in such a way that you have exactly the right amount of perfusion left, so that at baseline you don't have symptoms, but every time you exercise, for example, you will get ischemia.
Like unstable.
After a certain time. Yes, yeah. Exactly. So with unstable angina, then you get this. If you have unstable angina for a long time, then you will likely have abnormal tissue, while the tissue will not be structurally damaged, what happens is because of this prolonged kind of ischemia reperfusion that you get the stunned myocardium.
Mm-hmm. But it also could be like a tachycardia or high blood pressure.
Yes, everything that reduces the perfusion below the critical level needed to for the normal functioning will at some point induce this, indeed.
Okay.
There is still, there used to be, I think now it's a little bit less, a whole discussion on hibernating myocardium, for example, which came from the nuclear medicine scene, where they would see that you have tissue which is on echo functionally abnormal, but which still would have kind of perfusion and metabolism while not contracting. This is likely this kind of repetitive kind of stunning. So where you have a critical stenosis, where you then would get either unstable angina, or even if you don't have a lot of symptoms, but if you have the critical stenosis, what happens every time you increase your demand with exercise or something like that, you would get kind of partially ischemic. And then you get this kind of changes, you get the deformation changes, the functional changes, while, of course, your perfusion and metabolism overall can be kind of preserved.
Okay.
Thank you again for being here, and see you next week.